have this. And Samiya, congratulations on a 780, is it Q50 V48, I believe, right? It's an amazing, yeah. amazing score. It's just short of absolutely perfect, but I'd say it is absolutely perfect in the world of GMAT. And congratulations once again. So Samiya, let's talk about your GMAT journey. And so you're doing really well. You run your own nonprofit organization. You've been featured in Indian Express. I looked at your LinkedIn profile and so on and so forth as well. So someone who's very high achieving individual overall. And so when did you decide you wanted to really change over and go in for an MBA? And then what was your thought process behind the route you took?
So I was always pretty sure that I wanted to go for higher studies post my, my undergraduate education. So I did consider the GRE briefly for a while, but I realized that I did not want to dive into the technical field, rather, but was more inclined towards an MBA. Mm-hmm. So when it comes on to an MBA, there's always, doing it in India via the CAT and the other entrance exams that happen, or mm-hmm. via the GMAT. Some institutes in India do accept the GMAT, but primarily it's used for, international studies, I would say. So I was always more inclined towards the GMAT. Because I've never been very fond of math. I think I've explained that in detail in my debrief as well. So the entrance exams in India are extremely math intensive, and mm-hmm. I was never very fond of math. That is one. And the second thing is that I was always looking for a more holistic approach, I would say. And I've always had a lot of extracurricular activities since I was a child in school. So mm-hmm. I've always wanted a bit of a more of an international exposure and a more holistic experience, which I believe that international schools are often better positioned to give you. So, which is why I decided to do the GMAT. So I decided to do my GMAT when I was in my fourth semester of college.
Okay.
That was quite early. I know, like, it's rare. A lot of my classmates have told me the same thing, that it's rare for somebody to decide on doing their MBA.
When was this again? Which year are you talking about?
This was 2015.
2015, yes.
Yes. So 2015, November-ish is when I was very sure that I wanted to write a GMAT and go for my MBA. I was hoping that perhaps I could do it in a two-year frame. But then I slowly, as I did my research, I realized that most of the universities like a 3 to 4 year experience that tends to be the average at most of these schools. Mm-hmm. So I realized to give myself the best chance, I needed to sort of fall somewhere within that particular bracket. So then I started reading up about, what is the basic of a GMAT and what goes into it and all of that. But I never had a chance to really sort of sit down and, say, okay, this is when I'm writing the exam, or start my preparations for it properly, until I think late last year when I decided, yes, I want to get my GMAT done with.
Okay. So that is a really good idea of how you went about doing it. So you decided to leave your job to study for GMAT, right? And this was in October. Why did you make that decision?
So I wouldn't say I left my job to study for the GMAT, but rather I believe that I had decided to move on from my previous company, and I had decided to take a break because I wanted to spend some time consolidating my nonprofit organization.
And got it.
At the time, because I was at home, and my nonprofit is not at such a large scale that I needed to devote my entire day to it. I
got
didn't
it.
Have quite a bit of spare time. So it was almost like I could kill two birds with one stone. And plus, living at home affords you a lot of comforts that aren't really there if you're living by yourself in a different city. So I thought it was a good period as well. 3 months seemed to be quite a sufficient duration, I would say, for being able to prepare and give my GMAT. And plus, I also was able to juggle two things at the same time. So it kept me occupied as well, and often, gave me a diversion from each activity by going into the other.
So let's talk about your first attempt. How did you plan your first attempt? You started studying in October. You gave your first attempt on 29th of December. So walk me through the period during that time.
Sure. So I was always pretty sure that I wanted to attend some sort of physical classes. Though a lot of my friends who I'd spoken to, I first spoke to a lot of people to understand what goes into the GMAT. I think that's always step one, to really understand what it is that you're trying to crack, right? So I spoke to a lot of people who had done well at the GMAT and how they did it and, you know, what were the pain points to look out for, so as to speak. So most of my friends had actually done self-study or had done it via online courses simply because of the sheer flexibility that it offers you to, you know, set your own pace and work at your own time. But however, I've always known that I sometimes struggle with motivation and keeping myself disciplined and, you know, staying on track. So I really knew that I would personally benefit from a classroom program by physically having a class to wake up to and go to every day or every other day whenever there was class, and just physically devoting 2 hours to GMAT or 1 hour to GMAT depending on the class duration. So I decided that I was going to take up my classroom program, that was for sure. And the second thing I did was I decided to just write a very basic exam, a mock test, to kind of understand where I stand, because I was always of the belief that I would do quite well in verbal but struggle with quant, because that's how my sort of mindset towards it had always been. But to my surprise, my verbal score was not quite good, actually. My quant was not as bad as I feared. Like, I expected it to be very, very bad. It wasn't great, but it wasn't that bad either.
What was that mock score? Let's just...
So, it was actually, I think, a 600, I believe. I don't remember the exact split. I think it was a 30 verbal and like a 40 quant, I think, somewhere around that.
Okay, yes. I mean, I would say yes. It's both of them are in similar percentiles ones. And Q40, from what I understand, what Q40 really is, because I've seen how percentiles and quant have fluctuated over the last 10 years. I think it's a pretty decent starting point.
Yeah. So it wasn't too bad, but I was, the results were that I knew that I couldn't take verbal completely lightly, but I also knew that I did need to work on my quant as well.
Okay.
So I joined the classes in Chennai. I joined a physical classroom class. And I did that for about 6 weeks. So that really helped me solidify my concepts in quant especially. And I think it was helpful for me to just get into the routine, because I think a lot of us, what happens is once we finish college, we're out of the habit of studying. You know, we don't really sit down with our books that often, and it's really hard to get back into it. So I would really suggest that, you know, if there's anyone looking to write an exam, do it as quickly as they can once they're out of college, because it helps to be in that pattern of studying on a regular basis. So having that physical class actually helped me continue, like, or to get into the habit of studying on a fairly regular basis. I wouldn't say I was extremely regular, but fairly regular.
Okay.
So I started off with that, and by I think mid-November or something like that, I started trying to write my quants. I started trying to write my mock tests.
Mock tests, yes.
Yeah. So my mock test scores were quite good, actually. So I was very sort of encouraged by them, I would say. So I was scoring 750 plus, which was always my target. So because I was hoping to, be able to apply to almost all of the universities, I really knew that being an Indian student, somebody actually once told me that if whatever school you want to apply to as an Indian applicant, you could just take the average score and add a 20 to it, because
that's the right thing. Yes.
Yeah. It's extremely competitive, right? So I knew that to give myself a fair chance of applying to all the schools that I could potentially want to, I would like to target a 750 plus score. So to be hitting that target constantly in all of my mock exams was extremely encouraging.
Okay.
But I knew that in my verbal, for some reason, I struggled with SC because my English language is extremely colloquial. So it's more about, you know, speaking and, you know, picking it up and just being fluent in it by feeling the language, I would say. So when I used to do grammar in school, I would say, this doesn't sound right. I didn't know the terms. I didn't know the sort of the rules of grammar, but I would just say it didn't sound right. And that doesn't work for the GMAT, because all of the options, you know, most of the options sound right, and there's always some confusion. So my CR and RC were quite good. My RC especially, I didn't struggle with the reading passages because I had, habit of reading when I was younger. But there were a couple of tricks that I looked at, you know, picking up the more obvious answers instead of trying to build up my own interpretation in my own head. So I tended to fall into that trap, but I started recognizing the pattern the more I did, mock exams.
The more you practiced, yeah.
Yeah. But SC was something that I continued struggling with, and I just wasn't able to understand.
So let me just summarize this piece, because I think there's some people who'd be looking at this as well. You were someone who's a naturally good reader, good comprehension ability, and that came because you've been reading stuff since growing up. But the very fact that a lot of what you've been reading is written probably by Indians in Indian dailies, in sentence correction, it poses a problem because the language or the grammar or the sentence structure that you see in Hindustan Times or Indian Express, barring the Hindu, I think is still pretty decent. I have, at least from what I remember when I read the Hindu, a lot of what you see is the incorrect answer choices, that those structures would be used in Hindustan Times or Times of India overall. So I think, yeah, that does make sentence correction a bit more challenging for people who've been, who've really good readers, even those who are really good readers from India.
Yeah. And even the language that we speak, right, we tend to use there as a singular form a lot more often in the Indian context. So that was one thing I really struggled with, the phrases that I'm used to hearing in my day-to-day conversation were not grammatically correct according to the GMAT. Yep. So it was a bit of a transition to train my mind to look at it differently. But even then, I would be spending over 2 to 3 minutes on any given SC question. It was just not a very, I would say, appropriate time split.
Okay.
So I really was struggling with my SC especially. So I really wanted to work on that, which was when I took the e-GMAT. I attended the e-GMAT SC webinar first. Mm-hmm. And I think the webinar was the turning point for me in terms of, improving my SC. Because I was now able to approach a sentence by its meaning. And that was something I was a lot more comfortable doing rather than just simply mechanically scanning for splits and trying to apply rules to it. Because I had always been reading and comprehending things really fast, being able to understand the intended meaning behind a sentence really sort of helped me, work out those minor differences between the options and go for the right one. So I think the webinar really did the trick for me when it came to the SC. And I think after that, my verbal was quite constant at a 44. So most of my whatever exams I wrote, I was always at around a 42, 44 average. And I was quite happy with that as well. I did not have any issues. Mm-hmm. And my quant was also holding steady at a Q50. So when I gave my first attempt, I would have expected to have been confident about my exam. I was not, for other reasons. But the preparation aspect of it seemed quite okay, I would think.
Okay. So let's talk about from your first to second attempt briefly. You had a 740, V44, Q48, if I remember correctly. What was that? Q48, 47?
It was Q47.
Q47. And really tempting score, I would say. And then you said you were in a conundrum whether to take the exam again or not. And then you mentioned in your debrief, your mom pushed you. So tell me about the role that mom played in all of this.
So, to be honest, I think the biggest credit for my entire GMAT success story, if you would like to call it that, goes to my mom. Because, I would have days where I'm like, I don't want to study today. But she would always be like, half an hour a day. Just small steps, just so that you're in touch every single day. So, the thing is that before I gave my exam, I was extremely nervous. Primarily because of this whole mental block I had against math itself in general. Mm-hmm. So even though I was scoring constantly above a 750 in every single one of my mock tests, the GMAT mock test. So I got a 750 plus in all six. So I should have been quite confident. But instead, I started sort of doing more research and I started psyching myself out. So I would read up reports that would say the GMAT mock tests are a lot easier than the actual exams. Mm-hmm. So I would convince myself that I'm actually not prepared enough and, I'm just getting overconfident.
Very interesting.
And the weirdest thing was I never found any debrief on any of the forums that I read that spoke about the mental approach to the GMAT. And for me, that was what I ended up really struggling with, you know. I was extremely nervous about it. I had nightmares about the GMAT. I think, like I mentioned in the debrief.
Have you had nightmares about anything else?
No.
So you, in general, in your regular school exams, you've just been very cool. It was just about the GMAT.
So I've only had nightmares about a couple of academic exams. So I've done quite a bit of extracurricular activities, quite a bit of traveling, and I've had to speak on stage in front of a very large audience. But none of that has ever given me nightmares, you know. But an academy exam that involved a lot of math, very, you know, gave me a lot of nightmares. So I remember one, I had a 760 flashing on the screen. I blink and it converted to a 560 in front of my eyes. So, you know, I had nightmares like this quite a bit. And so I really psyched myself out a lot before my first attempt, I would say. So when I gave the first attempt, I remember in the one of the first 10 questions I got, one of them was a series question. And I just needed to find the possible sum of two values in the series. Very simple, basic arithmetic question. But when I wrote down the series, the first 10 terms of the series, I missed out the eighth term. So I wrote 1 to 10 without 8. And that was the answer. So I spent 3 minutes trying to identify that I had missed out 8. And I should be able to write 1 to 10, I would think. But you
that's
know,
a fair point. I mean, when you say this, I absolutely, I can understand what you're really talking about. I've had those as well. And I think there is that mental aspect to cope up with it. The one that I remember even to this day is, it's been two or three, but the one that I remember was my JE entrance exam. And I don't know, I think it's one of those things that that kind of work. One of my friends, who just, so when I was giving the exam, we had this thing, you'd have a math section, you'd have, and then you'd have a 2 hour break, then you have a physics, and then 2 hour break, and then you have chemistry. So between the math and physics section, the center was right next to his house. We went to his house and we were just lying down. He said, "Hey, Rajat, if there's a question around mixture of two gases and blah, 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 it was a thermodynamics question, how would we approach it?" And I told him that's how we'd approach it. And then one of the six questions in the exam was exactly that. And I messed it up. I knew I was messing it up. It was exactly this. It was a simple thing. I'd done this before and I knew it was I was messing it up. I checked it again and again and I messed it up and he solved it correctly. And so I know what you're talking about. And yes, I think there is that mental aspect that needs to be taught where you really say you can face a situation. You've got to know how to reset yourself or let it go one way or the other. But yeah, that's an aspect that you need to really learn.
Yeah. So my first attempt, like, because I'd made such silly mistakes, right? I got a Q47 and a V44. So I was completely happy with my verbal score. But I did feel that my quant score was very skewed. And I was partially a little apprehensive about that reflecting negatively in my applications. Because in some cases, they did look at the split. It wasn't that I was quantitatively not good enough. But rather more that, you know, in an exam situation, sometimes I struggled with, you know, the math of it, just simply because I was not very comfortable with those kind of situations earlier in my life. So I felt that it was not a fair reflection of my abilities. And I felt that I really could do better. And at some point, it became a challenge to myself to prove that.
It became an ego issue.
Yeah, that I could overcome the math exam, and I would defeat the quant section, so as to frame it. So I took a break. It was New Year's, so I took a break for New Year's, and I started my new job on the 8th of January. So
okay.
I was working full time after that, but actually I think that helped me because I was spending 8 to 9 hours at office, not thinking about anything else. So I wasn't having too much time to sort of get in my own head and psych myself out again. So it was just a couple of hours of just refreshing the concepts that were already there. And the rest of the time I was doing my own thing and I was busy and I was otherwise occupied. So that kind of helped me be a lot more calm this time around when I wrote my exam. And but on the day of the exam, I think I left my passport at home and this and that. And you know, my mom came to drop me off to the exam center, and she was like, "It's okay, just deep breaths. Maybe just start off with verbal." You know, one of my mentors actually suggested that he was a person who had already written the GMAT before, so he was someone I often spoke to for advice on approaching GMAT, what kind of resources to use, and all of that. So he'd suggested this idea before, but I personally had thought that, you know, I would just be happy getting quant out of the way so that I could focus on verbal. So, but because of, you know, the situation during the exam day, my mom was like, just go for verbal the first as the first section. And I did that, and I actually thought I screwed up verbal, to be very honest.
Okay.
Normally, I used to finish the verbal section with about 20 minutes to spare. I finished it with 1 minute to spare this time. And the questions just seemed a lot harder. And I would often catch myself reading the RC passage, but actually mentally trying to remember quant formulas because I was still obsessed with quant. So I had to like stop right there and be like, okay, no, you're reading the passage. Like read it again and actually understand what you're reading.
You reset yourself, see?
Yes, exactly. So I was still quite apprehensive about verbal when I went into quant, but I did not have time to sort of do that. So I had a couple of new strategies for quant this time around. So to catch myself not spending 5 minutes on a question just because it was a easy question, what I would do is I would just write down the starting minute for every question. So, you know, I would just be able to quickly check instead of trying to do mental math about how many minutes are left. It would just take me 2 seconds, but it just made me a lot more efficient in terms of time management.
Do you write this in your debrief?
Yeah, I think I mentioned it. Okay. Perhaps not in detail, but I think I briefly mentioned it.
Yeah, I think you should detail this out. It's a very important step. Essentially, what you've done is you've decluttered your thought process to really say your mind is not doing one additional thing. And because you made it a process, you're just naturally doing it. And I think that's a very small thing, but it's a very important thing.
Yeah. It definitely, I think, made a big difference in my time management this time around in quant. And I was able to make sure that I only spent 2 minutes or like at the most on a question or maximum three, but nothing more than that. So I was able to catch myself from, you know, sort of getting too involved into a question. So that
And really it's helped. Not just that. It also is, remember, when you're solving a question and you're done with it and then you have to go back to the scratch pad and write down the time, you are mentally disconnecting from the previous question because you have to take a look at your watch and then write it down. And which means when you start with the next question, you're that much more fresh when you start with the next question, even though it's just 2 seconds. Just that mere act of doing it is very, very, very important. And so that's a really important thing in an exam, if you can mentally disconnect yourself from a particular question. And I do that while solving questions, where in between questions, I just close my eyes for 5 seconds. It's just mental disconnection. And then you start again and you find the mind's a lot more receptive to receiving new information.
Yeah.
So,
I think that was pretty much my approach to the second time.
Well, that's good. Congratulations once again on a 780. So let's talk about your post MBA stuff right now, post GMAT stuff. So you, the schools that you're applying to, and let me look at the list. I have it on my phone. I remember reading INSEAD, which were there a few other schools, right?
I essentially said the top 5 to 7 in the US rankings.
Okay.
INSEAD, LBS, and I already have my admit at ESA as well.
Yes. So what? What do you plan to do in terms of, I mean, why choose the top 5 to top 7 schools?
I think the top 5, top 7 schools just offers you so much more of an opportunity and so much more of a platform, right? I think I still have 2 years to go before I apply for my MBA. So I'm really hoping to sort of pick or sort of freeze on one particular path that I want to take after my MBA and accordingly position my MBA towards that. Right now, I'm leaning towards consulting, but I also do run a nonprofit organization on the side. So I'm not really sure about the intersection of these two.
You can't do consulting and nonprofit. That's something which is not going to work.
Yeah, it's I know that the consulting is extremely time consuming, but I am hoping that, you know, I would get a taste of it in the in my tenure at McKinsey over the next year or so, so that I can decide if that's something I really, really want to do and whether it's worth all the sacrifices that would be required.
So at McKinsey right now, would you be traveling in the near future the way consultants do?
So I'm currently a data analyst, but we do have on-site client projects where we sort of don the hat of a consultant, and that would start coming in probably 6 to 8 months from now. So I would have a couple of opportunities to sort of travel on-site and actually be part of a consulting team.
Okay, I think that would give you a slight idea, but just strategy consulting, the way it is, it's a lot of travel, and it's grueling hours. Essentially, but it's a very interesting life overall, and so I think it's something when you're young you definitely enjoy it. One other thing that I'd really say is if consulting is something that you're really concerned of, that you really want to go into, Tuck is one school that I would very strongly recommend. As a percentage of graduating class, I don't think any school stands a higher percentage to top consulting firms than Tuck. And which is, as a school where it is, Tuck is in the middle of nowhere in the world. And given that it's in the middle of nowhere, the fact that it is able to do this is just amazing. So, I mean, top schools definitely send, you know, people in a boatload of people. Overall, if you look at Harvard, for example, top consulting firms host competitions at Harvard. And the reason for hosting competitions is to identify talent overall. So top schools would definitely serve you well at consulting if you want to get into consulting.
Yep. So for me, priority is when I look at finalizing my sort of school list that I would like to apply to. One of them is definitely the kind of opportunities that would come in post the MBA. So, you know, if I do have a taste of the consulting life and decide that, you know, I don't want to invest myself into a career that's so demanding, I might go into marketing, which is something that, you know, I'm quite interested in as well. So in that case, I would consider other options. So it kind of depends.
So I think that the way you want to look at an MBA is, you know, when it comes to top schools, most top schools will give you opportunity in pretty much any vertical, right? If you're looking for cookie cutter opportunities, that is, right? But then there is the other aspect that a top school brings about, which is unique to schools. So, let's take an example of two different schools, Stanford and Harvard, both top schools. But the kind of opportunities you're going to see at Stanford are going to be very different from the kind of opportunities that you're going to see at Harvard. And again, different from the kind of opportunities that you're going to see at MIT. Harvard versus Stanford, I think the first thing when you look at it, just the architecture, the structure of schools. Harvard is a very close environment. Classrooms are within big buildings and so on and so forth. Whereas Stanford is way more open. You have sunlight coming through every classroom. Classrooms are bigger and so on and so forth. So I think the environment in which you study is different. Now you may really say, I'm still in the classroom. It doesn't matter to me. But then remember, a lot of learning in an MBA happens outside of classroom. If you're someone who's scared to go outside in cold, you would really be focused and confined to classrooms. And things that happen within a particular spatial space. In Stanford, the weather is a lot more nicer, and you won't have to push yourself to go out as much. That's one aspect of it. Harvard, you're going to get the kind of corporate exposure that you're going to get at Harvard is unparalleled. I mean, every top firm comes there, every CEO of top firm comes there, and that's kind of a part of their culture. The kind of startup exposure you get at Stanford is unparalleled. I mean, that's something which you're not going to get at Harvard. Any new trend that you're going to really see in technology and in workflows is something that Stanford is going to be exposed to a lot more early on than Harvard would be. So from an education standpoint, if you purely look at courses, there isn't a whole lot to pick between Harvard and Stanford per se. But when you add all of these aspects, you're going to look at two different schools. Now, Harvard and MIT, it's right next to one another. You can actually run from Harvard to MIT. They're just that close to one another. Again, MIT very much technology focused, and hence different kind of exposure outside of the core classrooms. The Center of Innovation at MIT is just works very differently than the Center of Innovation at Harvard does. The focus, the kind of companies that come out are different. So again, the good thing is you still have a couple of years. You would have an idea of what you want to do. If you want to do corporate consulting or corporate, if you want to go the corporate route, there's no school that's going to better position you than Harvard would. If you want to go the startup route, you do my own thing route, MIT and Stanford, I think, would be better choices. Harvard would still expose you to all the VCs out there, but the kind of learning that you'll have through 2 years, you'd be much better served by Harvard and Stanford.
Right. So I hope to start my application process by sometime, I would say, mid-2019, I would think April or so, to give myself enough time to apply in round one for all of these top schools. So I think primarily another thing that I would definitely need to consider is financial aid if any of these schools do make offers of...
They do. All of them do.
The extent of it and all of that would definitely influence...
Here is something that I will tell you. You have an amazing score. You basically have a really good profile. You will get some financial aid. But in a top school, even if you have to take a loan, it doesn't matter. I mean, in 5 years from graduation, you would really look back and really say, hey, that taking that loan didn't matter a whole lot.
Fair enough. So I'm hoping to sort of spend the next year and a half or so just connecting with alumni and trying to really understand the culture of the schools, because I feel right now what I have of the understanding of schools that I have is extremely superficial. Mm-hmm. Like it's things maybe you'd read on just on the internet on a very basic level. You really need to understand the culture of the school because I'm hoping to do a 2-year MBA because it's my first MBA and I believe that a 2-year MBA would benefit me more than a 1-year MBA, which is slightly lower on my list. Than compared to the other programs that I hope to apply to. So I definitely, if I'm, spending or devoting 2 years of my life and, considerable resources to my MBA, I think the culture that you surround yourself really plays an important role. So I'm hoping to just connect with a lot of alumni from these different schools, just really talk to them to understand what kind of leadership, do they propagate? Because sometimes they say that, they have different leadership styles at different schools. And, you need to pick the one that you most strongly identify with, the kind of, the leader that you want to become and sort of, position yourself accordingly. So I'm hoping that I would be able to do that in the next year and a half and sort of really narrow down on a very clear cut post MBA plan. Because right now I feel I am a little bit vague, I would say. But
it's good to know that, by the way.
That I am a little vague?
Yes.
Yeah.
Most people don't really accept that realization. Everyone has it, but they don't accept it. They just think things would work out. But accepting that realization is a big thing. So that's good. I think one last thing, because I really need to go to my next meeting. But essentially, you talked about leadership styles. Leadership styles is something that schools don't exactly impart. But what you're going to really find with regards to culture is the proportion of certain kinds of leaders in a certain school is higher than so Harvard would have more of certain kind of leaders versus Stanford or versus MIT. So that's something that you're going to recognize. The good thing really is you're working at McKinsey, which means you have a lot of exposure to folks from these schools. So I think you'd really get to really see and work with those people, hopefully. And I think McKinsey's...
Question. So is there any aspect of my profile that you think I need to work on over the next year and a half, just before my...
Just achieve things. That's all I would say.
Okay.
You've been someone who's been achieving things. Just keep on doing that, making a difference. And I think that's about it.
All right, fair enough. So Sorry, so, you were saying something. I think I cut you off.
So what I say again? I think McKinsey still offers its employees the option to really do an MBA and then come back. And I think there is, if you get to that level, it will be a big boost to your application.
All right, fair enough. I will definitely keep that in mind and check that with my firm. All right, then I won't keep you long from your meeting. I understand. So yeah, it was great talking to you. Thank you so much for taking the time.
Likewise, Samiya. All right. Good luck. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye.